Hello everyone, welcome to this general overview of how to play Roll Saga Baseball. We do hope that through this video you'll gain a better insight into gameplay. Okay, let's start this off by taking a look at our pitcher on the mound and breaking down everything that we see on his pitcher's token. At the top, under the team name, we have the pitcher's handedness and usual rotation. Red is always left, blue is always right in Roll Saga. Coming down next, we have the pitcher's pitching ability, a plus number that's added to his two pitch rolls. Beside that, we see the pitcher's endurance, beneath which, in abbreviated form, is repertoire, which is the amount of pitches that he knows how to throw. When you have a pitcher on the mound in Roll Saga, if playing pitch-by-pitch mode, the pitch cards corresponding to the pitcher's repertoire will be extracted from the deck and used in-game. Let's put our first batter up for Miami. We have Juan Pierre, who we can see usually plays left field and has a special skill set as indicated by the asterisk. Anytime you see an asterisk on a player's token, it means that the player has a special skill set. We see Pierre bats and throws left, and his bat ability is plus one. He has a power rating of 10 feet. His glove and arm are both plus four, and he's a very fast runner with a 3.0 running speed. Pierre's running speed of 3.0 makes him a very fast runner, which is why he often bats first in the batting order as a leadoff hitter. He also has the stealing bases skill in his special skill set, which makes him a very good choice as the first batter up in the lineup. In Roll Saga, just as in true life baseball, players will be running the bases, so a fast runner in the leadoff hitting position will put him at a better chance of getting into scoring position. Juan Pierre has a special skill set as indicated by the asterisk after his usual playing position. While we won't go into detail about skill sets in this video, we will cover a few of his skills. He has reach, which allows Pierre to be able to better hit balls out of the strike zone. He has stealing bases plus one. He gets a plus one anytime he tries to steal a base. And he has range plus one. This is his quickness in the field, so he'll get a plus one when fielding hits not in his zone. All right, let's get him up to the plate. Sabathia will select his first pitch, a two-seam fastball. With a quick look at the pitcher's card, we see that our two-seam fastball drops two vertical zones on arrival with no lateral movement. We'll place our pitch chosen on the bottom of our pitch cards, hidden from our opponent, and use the ball token on the pitch pad to target our zone. Where we place our ball token is the target zone. This is what the pitch looks like as it comes into the batter. If the pitcher rolls a successful pitch, the ball will move to the grid as indicated by the pitching card or the pitch that he's throwing. In this case, the ball will drop two vertical zones. Okay, the manager with the pitcher on the mound rolls the pitch dice. The magic number needed for a pitcher to successfully make any pitch is 10 or higher. To this roll, he'll add his pit ability, which is his pitching ability. So pitchers with more control, usually better stats, have higher pit abilities. If a pitcher's roll equals exactly 10, then his pitch is successful, but he must reveal his pitch card. In other words, the batter does read the pitch, and the batter makes a decision based on this knowledge. So Sabathia rolls a 9, plus his plus 2, 11, so he makes his pitch. The batter takes a look at the first pitch and does not swing. He knows the pitch was successful, so the pitcher will reveal the pitch card and position the ball token according to the movement of the pitch. We see it is in the strike zone, so that's strike one. We're using the count strip included with all game boxes as a quick and easy way to keep count. We'll use the scoreboard for more permanent things like keeping the score or inning results. Alright, Sabathia will throw his second pitch. He'll throw a curveball this time. Remember, never let your opponent see your pitch card when you select it. Keep it hidden so that your opposing batter is unaware of what's being thrown. A quick look at our curveball's movement. Red always for lefties, blue always for righties. We see the movement for our curve is that it drops three zone and breaks one zone to the pitcher's glove side. So for our left-handed pitcher, here's how it will move if we successfully make our pitch. So the pitcher targets any zone on the pitching pad and rolls the pitching dice in an attempt to roll the magic number of 10 or higher. He makes his pitch, but Pierre lets it go by and does not swing, so we'll flip our pitch card over to reveal where our pitch actually ends up. Sabathia's pitch comes in the strike zone, so Pierre takes another strike, and that's strike two. All right, it looks like Sabathia is now going to throw his plus two four-seamer into the mix. We see that four-seam fastballs don't have any distinguishable vertical or lateral movement, and they look the same for either a right or left-handed batter. So the target zone, the appearance of the ball, that is, how it looks coming into the batter, is selected on the pitching pad and the pitch dice are rolled. A roll of seven is made. Adding Sabathia's plus two, we get nine, which is still not the needed 10. So we'll justify our pitch control dice to see where the pitch actually ends up. Regardless of how the pitch control die lands, we always rotate it to the right until we have the first edge exactly straight with the pitching pad or closest level edge in order to eliminate discrepancies between managers. This is called justifying in Roll Saga, so we always justify the pitch control die. As indicated by our pitch control die, used for a failed pitch, we move the ball token correctly. The pitch control die is referenced when a pitcher fails to successfully make his pitch, that is, does not achieve the magic number of 10 or higher. The pitch control die represents the pitcher's loss of control. Simply move the ball token one grid as indicated by the arrow on the pitch control die. This loss of control is seen by the batter and he'll make a decision based on this knowledge. Alright, Pierre, seeing the pitch come in a little tight but still in the strike zone, takes a swing at it. He rolls an 11, and his plus 1 bat brings a total to 12, which beats our pitcher's total, so it's a hit. Our hit type die, the green die, is a 2. So Pierre hits a hot grounder, as indicated by the green hit type die rolled. A hot grounder is a little harder to field in the grass with a minus 1 subtracted from the fielder's roll. We see the other hit types here, and they're all very easy to memorize. All right, Pierre will roll again to determine the direction of his hit and the potential or maximum distance of the hit. He rolls a 51 on direction and a 6 on distance. When reading the two white die for our direction, we always read them as digits instead of a total. So in this case, we have 51 instead of a 6. Our third green die, we multiply by 50 feet and add our batter's power ability to get the potential distance. Looking out on the field, we'll find our 51 direction zone in red because Pierre's a left-handed hitter, and we'll get a look at the distance as well. The field is divided into 14 direction zones to account for the direction of any hit made, with the labels taking in account that right-handed hitters are more likely to hit to left field and vice versa. This is the reason for the two sets of numbers, red and blue. The field is also divided into distance zones, each zone marked at 50 feet. The distance zones are to easily determine the distance or potential distance of hits and fielding plays. The field is a scaled model. Every inch is equal to 20 feet. So the arcs that you see out on the field are the distance zone markers set at every 50 feet. Out on the field, we see where the 300 feet line is. We'll put our ball token on the field to keep track of the play. The hit, a hot grounder, will have to travel by New York's second baseman, Robinson Cano, so he'll have a chance to snag it. In order to successfully field a ball, the magic number needed is 7 or higher. 2 six-sided dice are used in fielding. To this roll, the player's glove ability is added to the total. The magic number needed to throw accurately to another player is also 7 and uses 2 six-sided dice. To the throwing roll, the player's arm ability is added. Robinson Cano has a +4 glove, so we'll add that to our roll. Cano rolls an 8. The ball is in play, so Pierre heads to first base. All base paths have markers indicating the distance in feet along the paths. These are used with the player's speed in determining advancement. The faster a runner is, the farther he will be able to advance during the course of a play. Back to our fielder, the Cano's roll of 8 will add his +4 glove. They take off 1 for the hot grounder and 1 for it not being in Kano's zone. We still come up with a solid 10. That's higher than our needed 7, so Cano fields the ball. And another 8 indicates that Cano successfully gets the ball to first base to beat out the runner. If using the Roll Saga scorecard, you'll go ahead and make your notations now. The Roll Saga scorecards come with your game box. Okay, let's get the next batter up to the plate, which is Polanco, who bats right and with a +1 and a 10 feet power ability, not a very fast runner at 1.5. And let's put the batter after Polanco into the on-deck circle, which is Giancarlo Stanton, who looks to be a little bit of a threat at a +3 bat, 40 foot power ability, and he's also a right-handed batter. And New York Sabathia goes through his available pitches that he can throw, and looks like he decides on a slider. So the target zone is marked on the pitching pad. He'll have it look like it's coming straight down the middle. And rolling the pitching dice, a roll of 8 is made. We add Sabathia's +2 ability to bring us at 10 for our roll. This is a successful pitch. However, anytime that exactly 10 is achieved, we must reveal our pitch card to the batter. In other words, the batter reads the pitch correctly and can make a decision based on that knowledge. So, the ball token is moved to the correct place on the pitching pad as indicated by our pitch's movement on the card. Polanco sees it's outside the strike zone and he'll take a ball. The count is 1-0. Sabathia makes another selection of a pitch to throw and decides to ease in his two-seam fastball, also known as a sinker. And the pitch dice are rolled and wow, Sabathia gets double sixes, which is always good. Double sixes always indicate an extraordinary play, and snake eyes, double ones, always indicate a critical or negative result. Looking on our handy quick reference chart, which a lot of beginners will use but will easily memorize it after a few games, we see that for pitching, double sixes indicates an automatic strike. We'll do a quick second roll following our double sixes to see if we roll double sixes again. If so, we could get an automatic strikeout. We don't do it in this case. With a 1-1 count, Sabathia will shuffle through to choose another pitch. He decides on his four-seam fastball, which at +2 would be 2 points harder for a batter to hit if he did swing at it. The pitch dice roll comes to a 5, adding our +2 is 7, still not enough. So let's look at the pitch control die to see where Sabathia's pitch ends up. Moving the ball accordingly puts the pitch on the inside of the strike zone for Polanco. So he'll swing. He'll need to beat Sabathia's total roll of 7, 5 on the dice with his +2 added. Polanco rolls a 6 with a 2 as his hit type. A 2 is another hot grounder. Polanco will roll again to determine the direction of the hit as well as the potential distance. He rolls a 34 and a 3 for distance. We'll reiterate that 2 dice for determining the direction of a hit are to be read as digits and they're not to be totaled up. We'll multiply our distance die, a 3, by 50 feet and add our batter's power ability, which altogether gives us a 160 foot potential distance. We find our directional field zone on the field, which is a blue 34, and we'll see our distance as well. But before Polanco's grounder can reach its maximum distance, it'll have a chance to be fielded by the pitcher, Sabathia. Sabathia rolls the dice to try to field Polanco's grounder. He rolls an 8, so he successfully fields the ball. Meanwhile, Polanco heads to first base. He'll be advancing according to his running speed ability. Sabathia, with the ball in hand, will make a throw to first base. He rolls. His throw is good. Lyle Overbay, playing first base, will roll for the catch, and whoa, not good. He gets snake eyes. The critical role of snake eyes for a fielder in catching the ball is definitely a lost ball and an error, but he'll have to make a save against the injury roll, but as long as he doesn't roll snake eyes again, he'll be good. Polanco is safe at first base. Overbay will get the error. Lyle Overbay now makes his save against injury roll. If he rolls snake eyes again, he'll have an injury, anywhere from one game to more on the disabled list, but he does not get an injury. Okay, we'll clear the count strip and go ahead and mark down the error on the scoreboard. If using the scorecards, we'd want to write out the play as well. Stanton is now up to the plate, batting at plus 3 and with a 40-foot power ability. He has an average running speed of just 1.5. In the on-deck circle comes Logan Morrison, who plays left field, but in this game is at first base for Miami. A quick look at Morrison's player token. He bats plus 2, power plus 10 feet. It runs a little quick at 2.0. Back on the mound, Sabathia takes a look at Stanton, who is definitely a threat and with a runner on first base. He decides on a slider and has a look to Stanton as a little high and almost inside. The pitching dice are rolled, which results in a 6, plus Sabathia's plus 2 is still only 8. So it's a failed pitch, and the pitch control die will have to be consulted after we justify it. Oh, that puts the pitch way up high, unmistakably a ball, and definitely out of reach, so Stanton will take the ball. Sabathia will now change it up with his curveball, and he'll have it look to come in on the opposite side of the plate, but actually targeting low in the strike zone if successful. This is unknown to Stanton. The pitch die roll results in 4 plus Sabathia's plus 2. Still not good enough. The ball travels way up high again. Stanton takes the ball, bringing the count to 2 balls and no strikes. Looks like Sabathia is going to try to blaze in his plus 2 four-seamer in past the obvious threat at bat. He'll have him looking low in the zone. Sabathia rolls the pitch dice and gets a natural 8, and adding his plus 2 brings it to a 10. But as he did not beat the magic number of 10, only matched it, his pitch, while successful, will be read by the batter. And it's right down the middle. Stanton swings, rolls a 10, and gets a 5 on the hit die, which is a fly ball. And we'll get our ball token ready. Stanton now rolls for the direction and distance, and ouch, he rolls snake eyes on direction, with a 4 for the distance roll. Snake Eyes, a critical role is never good. Taking a quick look, we see that a critical Snake Eyes role for a batter in this position is an easy pop-up for the catcher. It should be an easy catch for Stewart. The roll is made, resulting in a natural 8 plus Stewart's plus 2, brings the total to a 10. That's an easy out. Now we'll put Stanton back in the dugout. And we'll bring up Morrison to the plate. Morrison is a left-handed hitter with a plus 2 batting ability, plus 10 feet power ability, and he runs at a decent 2.0. Justin Ruggiano steps into the on-deck circle. He bats a plus 2, plus 30 feet power ability, and runs at a good 2.0. Sabathia again rifles through his repertoire. And he decides on a slider. He has a look to come in high in the strike zone. He gets a 7 on the roll, adds his plus 2, comes to 9, not quite good enough, but the ball still is in the strike zone. Morrison takes a swing and strikes. Sabathia again shuffles through his arsenal and gets ready to throw his plus 2 heater. He has it appear low in the zone. Rolls a 5, plus 2 is 7. The ball comes in right down the middle. Morrison takes a swing and rolls a 3. That's strike 2. The count is now 0-2. Sabathia fans through his pitching repertoire for the 0-2 pitch, decides on a curveball, looking to be a little up in the zone. The pitch dice are rolled and gets a natural 11, plus Sabathia's plus 2 gives it a total of 13. The batter lets it go by and takes a ball. Sabathia takes a minute to strategize his next pitch as the count is 1-2. He ultimately decides on a two-seam fastball, also known as a sinker. Another roll of the pitching dice, gets a 6 plus his pitching ability of plus 2, brings it to an 8. Looks like Sabathia is not having the best results, but he has not given up any runs. The count is now 2-2. Sabathia thinks about the 2-2 pitch and looks like he's going to try to burn him with a 2-2 four-seam fastball. And this is, in fact, usually the best pitch to throw in a 2-2 count. And Morrison will swing at the ball in the strike zone. Oops, dice off the table. We'll have to do a re-roll. Morrison gets a 6 plus his plus 2, falls short of Sabathia's 11, and Sabathia strikes him out. That's 2 outs for Miami. Morrison is retired and Ruggiano up to the plate. Justin Ruggiano is a right-handed hitter with a plus 2 batting ability, plus 30 feet on power, and he runs at an agreeable 2.0. Solano walks up into the on-deck circle. Sabathia rifles through his arsenal once again and comes up with the decision to throw his slider. Looks like he's trying to slide it in close to Ruggiano, maybe to intimidate him. And Sabathia rolls a paltry 3. He is just not getting good rolls today. And the ball ends up right down the middle. And Ruggiano wants a bite at that pitch, so he swings. He rolls the dice to come up with a natural 7, plus 2 makes 9, plus his opposite batter advantage makes 10. He gets a hit with his hit type being a high line drive, which is a line drive, plus 50 feet. And Ruggiano will roll his direction and distance, coming up with a 26 on direction and 250 feet. To the 250 feet will also be added 50 feet for the highline drive and Ruggiano's own power of 30 feet, bringing the total to 330 feet. And looking out onto the field, we'll find the direction zone, in this case a blue 26, and we'll put our ball token at the correct distance to get ready to play it out. And as just mentioned, Ruggiano has a power of plus 30 feet, so we'll add that in addition to the 250 and 50 feet for the line drive for a grand total of 330 feet. Runners advance on the baselines according to the play at hand. And New York center fielder Brett Gardner will have a chance to catch the line drive. We see Gardner has a plus 1 glove, so he'll add that to his roll in trying to get a 7 or better. And he'll also subtract 1 from his roll as the ball is 1 zone over from his zone. Gardner rolls a cool 9, adds his plus 1 glove to make 10. Subtracts the 1 for out of zone and comes up with an easy catch at a total of 9 for his fielding roll. And the bottom of the inning is over, as well as our demonstration of pitch by pitch mode. But stay tuned and we'll briefly break down how to play Roll Saga without doing pitch by pitch. Now let's take a very quick look at how gameplay flows without the use of pitch by pitch mode. And since we're not doing pitch by pitch, we'll not need the pitching pad, so we could take that off the game mat. And just a real quick note, the pitching pads are made of the same durable and flexible material that the game mat is made of. And in the process of developing this game, we've only ever used the best materials because we really do want this game to last a long time. But we'll need the ball token, however, to use for any hits and running plays. Without pitch-by-pitch mode, the game comes down to a pitcher's roll versus the batter's roll, adding in all abilities as usual. We see here that our pitcher strikes out the batter, that's out 1, and the batter is retired. The following batter in the lineup and from the dugout will step into the on-deck circle. Sabathia rolls, gets a 7, we add his plus 2 to make a total of 9. And the batter, Pierre, rolls an 8, adds his plus 1 bat and his plus 1 opposite batter to come up with a 10. He gets a hit, a grounder. Play would continue like this with other rules in place, but without the pitch-by-pitch mode, this is a faster-paced game for those that want it.